Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Achieving High Throughput for Real-Time Applications with SMAC, Kafka, and Spark Streaming webinar. My name is Aline Zhu, and I am the Product Marketing Manager at DataStacks. Today, we have Ryan Knight, Enterprise Solution Engineer at DataStacks, here to speak about estimating the size of your data pipeline, its impact on the overall architecture of your application, and the five most important considerations when developing a data pipeline. At the end of the webinar, we will be addressing questions, so please be sure to submit your questions in the Q&A panel. All right, Ryan, you can take it away.
Hello, Ryan Knight. So as Patrick was kind of talking about last time, he talked about, you gave an overview of the SMAC stack, the Spark, Mesos, Okta, Cassandra, Kafka, and how it can be used to build data pipelines. What he talked about last time is just a quick review is how Kafka basically allows you to decouple your data pipelines by acting as a message queue. And it really provides order from chaos by creating a queue to line up your data in order for processing. And so once it, you know, it stores the data into Spark and it can be processed with other systems such as Okta. And then it's all, Mesos can be used to scale this all out. So you can scale all of your processes out using Mesos. The nice thing about Kafka is that it divides the data, right? You can put your data into topics, and those topics can be divided into additional partitions. And that allows you to scale out Kafka very nicely. And so then in this webinar, we want to talk about the overall data pipeline between Kafka and Spark Streaming specifically, and how we can scale that out. So why is it important to learn about data pipelines? So the real benefit of building data pipelines is moving from a proactive analytics to predictive analytics. So proactive is batch analytics. This is the traditional way that data analytics has always been done. And that's when, you know, on a daily basis, a weekly basis, the business gets a data dump, and then they do all the analytics on it. So it's this delayed processing. So what real-time analytics gives you is it gives the businesses real-time insight into the state of the business and allows them to make real-time decisions. And the challenge is dealing with this massive volume of incoming data. So how do you build a data pipeline that can handle the data that's flowing in real-time? And how do you build a data pipeline that's high quality so you're not losing any of your data, so you're not, you know, having, you know, you don't lose servers, your servers aren't flying over because of the massive volumes of data you're dealing with. So this is becoming more and more common use case today. There's a lot of use cases that I've seen, fraud detection in banking, like web login analysis, web traffic analysis, marketing data. These are all different ways of, that are, all of these are companies that are using these streaming pipelines to analyze their businesses and to make smarter decisions. So the challenge is that, right, as I mentioned, is how do you deal with this massive volume of data that's streamed in? And really the best solution today is Spark Streaming. So the Spark Streaming combined with Kafka provides these ideal tools for handling these massive volumes of data that's pouring through your enterprise. When we talk about building, you know, large scale data pipelines, one of the key things is how do we scale that data pipeline? How can we parallelize the processing of that data? How do we parallelize ingestion of the data, and then how do we parallelize the storage of that data? So what we want to look about out at today is how we scale that out, how we can parallelize our processing. The other part of that is resilience and fault tolerance. So as that data is flowing into your enterprise, you want to capture every last piece of your data. You want to ensure that your data is not lost. You want to ensure the high quality of that data. And so your data pipeline also needs to be resilient and fault tolerant. So it's more than just scaling the data pipeline, it's also ensuring that there's no errors or lost processing. So how do we scale for load and for traffic? So if you guys have seen the movie The Italian Job, it's a very famous movie. They wanted to do a gold heist and figure out how they can get these large stacks of gold, divide them up into the minis, and sneak the gold out. So the idea was to take these stacks of gold and figure out how to distribute it between the cars. So really, with building our data pipelines with Kafka and Spark Streaming, we want to do something very similar, of taking our data, figuring out how to spread out the load, and distributing it into a fashion that can be easily processed. For a quick review, if you haven't worked with Spark Streaming, what it is what Spark Streaming does is it basically takes your data into this continuous sequence of micro batches. So what it's going to do is it's going to take the data that's flowing in, it's going to batch it together into small batches and then process each one of those batches as an individual analytics job. Those small batches can be from, 500 milliseconds up to a couple of seconds. That's tunable and configurable. So when we start talking about Spark Streaming, we're going to talk about it in terms of these micro batches of data that we're processing. So let's go into the five keys to scaling Spark Streaming with Kafka. So these are the five most common ways of scaling. And as part of this, I'm going to first go over event sourcing, the data modeling, then avoid network shuffling, how we tune Spark Streaming for processing time using the Kafka Direct API, and then the fifth point is sizing Spark Streaming. So the first thing is our data model. So the data model is key. So having an effective data model that allows us to quickly capture and store our data is key. This is going to provide much better performance as we store the data into Cassandra, and it's also going to provide a much simpler way of dealing with the data as it flows through. So the data model that we recommend using is event sourcing. And what this is instead of keeping track of, for example, if you're keeping track of a basketball game, you're not going to be having an exact score of team A and team B. So that you don't want to have that exact score. You don't want to have an asset transaction that's locking the score for team A, the score for team B, because those asset transaction locks don't scale. So when you go to a large-scale distributed system, you can't have the traditional asset transactions of a relational database. So instead, we go to a data model using event sourcing. So what we're going to keep track of is the events as they happen in real time. So in our basketball game, we keep track of the baskets as they're being made. And what this is going to give us is an event log of what happened during that game. And then to calculate the score, we basically are just going to do a roll-up of that data. So now we have a database of facts of what happened. Why is that important is, for one, it's idempotent. It allows you to, because each of those events has a timestamp, if anything is duplicated, if we ever write twice, those overwrites, it'll just overwrite. That allows the event stream to be scaled out horizontally very nicely, because we're only adding to these events. The next thing to think about is avoiding network shuffling. So with Spark is a distributed cluster, does the distributed cluster processing of your data. So as that data gets loaded into memory and to process, what can happen if you don't design your jobs properly is they can end up reading and writing data back and forth across the network, generating a lot of network traffic and a lot of network I/O, and which is going to have a significant impact on the performance of your application. So there's a number of common ways of avoiding network shuffles with Spark Streaming. The most common use case the most common problem that causes network shuffles is to have a lookup table. So as an example, this is an example I'm going to show later, is you want to gather ratings on a movie. So you might have a set of movies. You might have the most common set of movies. And so as those ratings are coming in, you want to do a join of that data against those movie ratings. You want to join those ratings against a set of movies. So the problem is if you're having to do a lot of network shuffling to look at those movies every time you're trying to, the data is flowing in. So there's a number of tricks in Spark that you can do to avoid this network shuffling. One is, for a smaller data set size, you can do broadcast joins. In Spark, what a broadcast join essentially does is it basically makes a hash map of your data, and it broadcasts that to all your nodes. So what's going to happen is I'm going to have a small lookup table be transformed into this hash map and then sent to all the different nodes. And so when it does the streaming, right? The streaming will do the join with that local data, and so it's not having to go out across the network to find the data. The second thing you can do is a join with Cassandra table. The join with Cassandra table is going to allow you to execute a single query for every partition source, so no unneeded data will be requested or serialized. This means that a join between any of the RDDs and Spark and the Cassandra table can be performed without doing a full table scan. And so doing that full table scan on a join would have a significant performance impact. By doing this join with the Cassandra table, I'm avoiding that overhead. And that's going to provide a significant advantage over avoiding this network shuffling of all my data. Another thing you can do is you can use the data frames. The new data frames has the Catalyst Optimizer. And what it tries to do is it tries to figure out the best join strategy for you. So you can use data frames, or you can force it to do, you know, a broadcast join if you want to ensure that it's doing the right choice. So next, let's talk about the Spark streaming processing time and how we tune that. So when you're processing today, we talked about Spark streaming as doing micro batches. So it receives those micro batches of data in, and each of those micro batches has to be processed. And so the processing time for those micro batches has to be less than your batch duration. Because what happens is the total delays can end up, right, because if I'm not processing my time less than my batch duration, the total delays for processing data is going to grow unbounded. So it's going to continue to grow up and up and up and out. I like this penguin gift because every time you watch it, you keep thinking of the penguin, you keep giving hope for that penguin to make it across the ice field. He keeps tripping. So there's always hope that, you know, you can fix things and keep going. So let's look at what we mean by processing time is less than batch duration time. So in this example, right, we had batch windows of 500 milliseconds, right, but the processing time was 1 second and 1 second, 500 milliseconds. So what ended up happening over time is we got a scheduling delay of 41 minutes. What that means is that as Spark Streaming is receiving that data in and trying to process it, it's putting everything in this backlog queue for processing, and that processing backlog is continuing to grow over time. So this particular example, right, we had this massive backlog, so it was taking each batch job 41 minutes until it was being processed, and that time was just growing linearly. So what we want to do is you need to do one of two things. You either, you know, adjust your batch sizes or you adjust your processing time so that you don't have these scheduling delays. So what we want to do is we want to set the right batch interval. A good approach to figuring out the right batch size for your application is to test it with conservative batch intervals, say like around 5 seconds and a low data rate. So kind of start at kind of a smaller end, verify whether your system is able to keep up with that smaller data set. And then you can check the value of the end-to-end delay experienced by each batch. And if the delay is maintained to be comparable to the batch size, then the system is stable. So here, right, we had a larger batch window. So we saw, you know, our batch windows was 5 seconds. The processing time was 3 seconds. And so our total delay stayed around 3 seconds. So we didn't have a growing delay, and we weren't having this growing backlog in the Spark streaming. So the next key is to use the Kafka Direct API. So just a high-level review of Kafka, if you've never used Kafka before. Kafka, basically, you create topics. The topic is the queue that your data gets written into. Those topics can be divided into partitions. So those partitions are a way of allowing Kafka to scale, essentially, right? So that's just a way of dividing up the number of places I can write to, so I can have, you know, a large number of writes. And then as it writes it, what it does is it basically has an offset. So the offset is the number in that message queue. So there's, you know, like offset 0, 1, 2, 3. So that offset is used by the reader to tell where, you know, which of my messages I've read. So, you know, if I read offset 5, then I can keep track of those offsets, keep track of where I've read out of that Kafka topic. So with the Kafka Direct API, how it's different from the legacy Kafka integration was previously Kafka, the Spark Streaming have to read the data using the Spark Streaming receiver. What that actually essentially did is that we copy the data into the receiver, prepare it for processing, and then copy that data again into the batch job. So there was actually, you'd have to do two copies of the data for resilience and high availability. You'd actually have to do a write-ahead logging, make a copy of that, say that data out to a write-ahead log to be sure that it wasn't lost. And then it also involved using ZooKeeper to keep track of it. So there's a lot of additional pieces and overhead. With the new Kafka Direct API, all it does is it goes out to Kafka and it says, all right, give me the data at this offset. And then from that offset, it pulls that data directly in for processing. And there's a number of key advantages to using this, of being able to pull this data directly off of Kafka without having to keep track of the, without having to do any of this write-ahead logging or additional copying of data. The biggest advantage is the number of partitions in my Kafka topic, they're equal to the degree of parallelism. So the more partitions I have, the greater parallelism I'm going to have on Spark Streaming. So this makes it very easy to parallelize Spark Streaming. I don't even have to think about how I'm going to parallelize my Spark Streaming. All I have to do is adjust the number of partitions in Kafka. It also makes for much greater efficiency, right? Because I'm only doing a single copy of data on read, and I'm not having to make multiple copies of the data. It's a much simpler API to work with. And then it also provides resilience without copying data, because what I can do is I can keep track of those offsets. So I can keep track of where I've read the data from, and then I'm only having to keep track of, and then if I have any kind of failure, I can just see what the last offset read was and then go back and start from that same point. Because it's greatly simplifying the infrastructure needed and the overhead, it actually really streamlines the amount of processing I can do by using this Direct API. And finally, let's talk about sizing our Spark Streaming batch sizes. So sizing is critical to being sure that, we talked about we want to keep our Spark Streaming processing time down. So sizing properly is key to that. And so let's talk a little bit about how we do that sizing and how to get our proper batch sizes. Really the goal to proper sizing is we want to reduce our processing time by increasing parallelism. So we want to increase the amount of servers and the CPUs that are available to reduce our processing time and get down the processing time to get down below the threshold. So if you look at, if you can read the one on the left, you see the schedule delay of 1 minute, right? Because the processing time is 25 seconds. On the right, we've introduced additional Kafka Spark partitions, which has paralyzed the reads and the processing of that data. Right, because we've gone from one Kafka partition up to 100 Kafka partitions, we're now paralyzing our stream processing. And that's moved the scheduling delay down to 135 milliseconds, right? And it's kept our processing time down around 3 seconds. So this has allowed us to keep within those the batch windows, the micro batch windows. So how do we size our data pipeline? Well, the key is to look at the data flow for the entire pipeline. You want to look at all the data that's flowing into Kafka, try to get a big picture of the overall data pipeline, and then size your entire pipeline accordingly. So the first part of this is benchmarking is key. So there's all sorts of estimates that are out there, recommendations of sizing. What you have to do really is you have to figure out a small chunk of, a small stream job that you can start doing to start testing, how much processing your individual servers can handle, and then calculating right based from that. So, based on looking at how much the an individual server can, how much they can process, and then calculating the number of messages flowing into Kafka, we can start to get an overall view of our data pipeline and how much data we can process. So let's first talk about sizing Spark. So the key idea of sizing Spark is that the number of CPU cores is the maximum number of parallel tasks. Right, what happens in Spark is that RDD is internally divided into partitions based on our data set size. And so the number of tasks on those partitions is directly correlated to the number of CPU cores. So what we can look at is the data transformations that are happening on one partition. And if we look at those data transformations and we start thinking about the number of tasks that we're running, we can look at that and kind of get an estimate of the number of cores. In the Spark Management Console, we can look at how that RDD is being partitioned and the data set sizes to get an idea of how that data is being divided up. And then from based on that, basically, we can start to figure out what the CPU sizing we are going to need. And then the other thing is, right, I showed those previous windows, right, using these streaming statistics, we can also see the input rate, right, of the amount of events happening per second, which is going to give us, this is the amount of data that I can handle on this particular server. So the input rate there was 85,000, so I could handle 85,000 events per second on this particular instance. So then we want to look at Kafka. We want to look at the amount of data flowing into Kafka and figure out how much data is flowing into our overall system. So we can look at use the Java Monitoring and Management Console and look at the rate of data flowing in and take that. So in this example, this was 248,000 messages a second in this example. So we get these numbers that are giving us how much data is flowing through our system and how much each of the pieces of our system can handle. And then based on that, we can come up with a very basic formula. So the total servers we're going to need is basically equal to the number of Kafka messages divided by the number of messages your streaming server can process. So for example, if Kafka has 100,000 messages flowing in, you know, we've done benchmarking to see that our servers can handle 20,000 messages, then we're going to need 5 servers. So to kind of put this into a big perspective of how you can build these data pipelines, scale them, and start testing them, I have built an example project called Spark at Scale. It's available out on GitHub under my GitHub ID, RetroRyan, /Spark at Scale. And what this does is it uses Akka to generate the messages and dump them into Kafka. We're going to cover Akka in a later webinars, but you can basically think of Akka as an event-driven framework for building highly scalable applications. And what I'm doing is I'm using Akka to scale out the event generation, generate a large number of movie ratings, and dump those into Kafka. And then on the Spark streaming side, I'm picking the data up off of the Kafka queue, processing it, and storing it into Cassandra. This particular example, I'm using the DataStax Enterprise platform, which provides a combined, basically it's a data platform that runs Spark Streaming Cassandra as an integrated application to make it very easy to build the distributed clusters of Spark and Cassandra. I'm not going to go through the code. The code's in the slide, and then there's the data's out there on GitHub. Just at the high level of the way you think about it is the Akka basically sends itself messages, and those messages get put into Kafka. And then on the Spark streaming side, as those data is flowing in, I'm converting each of those data to a data frame and storing those out into Cassandra. So I'll turn it back over to our host and for any questions.
Great, thanks, Ryan. We do have a couple questions that have come up, so let me just pull that up real quick. First is actually a compliment. I love the Italian job analogy one participant mentioned, Ryan. His question is around, can you talk about the options for connecting Spark to Cassandra?
Yes. So there's a Spark, there's an open source project that's maintained by DataStax, but it's put out into the open source community called the Spark Cassandra Connector. And it basically provides that connectivity between Spark and Cassandra. What it does is it reads the data out of Cassandra and stores it in a Spark RDD, so it transforms that data automatically for you into the Spark RDD format. And then it also allows you to save that data back out. So it takes an RDD and serializes it back into Cassandra. And so it automatically translates your Cassandra types back and forth between Spark and Cassandra. It also does a lot of things to optimize loading your data. So it does things like filtering the data. So if I wanted to work with a large data set size, the Spark Cassandra connector will actually push that filter down into Cassandra, filter the data, and only get the data back that I need. So I'd recommend going out to the, just if you Google for the Spark Cassandra connector, you'll see that project out there. And that's the ideal way of working with it too.
Great, thanks Ryan. Another question is, besides JMeter, is there any other tool suggested for benchmarking and monitoring?
JMeter is one. So I've got my own tool with Kafka. Right, and then, in terms of, by being able to generate load, JMeter is definitely one option. The other one is, I can't think of the name of it right now. There's another one tool built specifically for Scala. I'll post it in the follow-up notes. I'll post it on my Twitter handle as a follow-up note. It's Gatling. So Gatling is another great load testing tool that I've used.
Great. Thanks, Ryan. A few more questions. Can you talk about security around Kafka Spark streaming with regards to PCI requirements?
I do not have any details on that. We can follow up with that one later on.
Okay, great. As far as the Spark Cassandra connector goes, is it optimized for Spark streaming only or for others like Spark, SQL, et cetera?
It's optimized for both Spark streaming and for Spark SQL. So it is built both for batch jobs and for streaming. And the reason, and part of that is if you think about how Spark was designed, everything is actually a batch processing in Spark. And so really, the streaming is just building on the batch processing. And so the Spark Cassandra connector, because the basic architecture of Spark works really nicely in both the streaming and the batch modes.
Okay. Great. Time for probably one or two more questions. One question is the open source connector mature enough for production use?
Oh, we have, so I actually work with a lot of production customers. I work with a lot of Fortune 500 customers myself on the West Coast, and then I also collaborate a lot with the East Coast teams. And we have literally hundreds of customers in production with Spark Cassandra. And these are Fortune 500 companies that are, household names, all the way down to the small startup to the largest enterprises are using it in production, and it's been out for a long time now. It's very stable. It has a large team on it, so I definitely recommend it for production use.
Okay, great.